The College of Visual and Performing Arts at IPFW, offering degrees in fine arts, music, theater, and visual communication and design. IPFW, the energy of arts.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for being with us for another introduction to the Fort Wayne Philharmonic's Masterwork season. This is for the 2011-2012 season. And this season begins on September the 10th at the Embassy Theatre with what I think is an incredibly exciting program. We're going to start off with a work by Bach, or at least we think it's by Bach. It might not be. It's his Toccata and Fugue in D minor. And many people think this is actually his most famous piece, but it quite possibly isn't by Bach at all. It is a piece that has come down to us traditionally without there being any sort of manuscript at all. And most scholars think that it was actually composed around about 1750 or later than that, and the style isn't really the style of Bach. Although there's another theory that it's actually a violin work of Bach's that was badly transcribed by somebody else. Whatever the truth of all of this, we know this work orchestrally, most of us, from Walt Disney and Fantasia. And I make no apologies that there seems to be a Disney link to the beginning of the season, and you'll see the close of the season as well. Anyway, in 1927, the conductor Leopold Stokowski orchestrated the Toccata and Fugue and presented it with the Cincinnati Orchestra and the Philadelphia Orchestra. It's a very grand, very exciting piece of music. And Stokowski, you see, had actually been an organist in London before he came to this country. And he was the organist in St. James in Piccadilly. And if you've ever been to London and been down Piccadilly, St. James is a lovely little church opposite the Royal Academy and near Fortnum and Mason's, that famous department store there. So that's where Stokowski did his musical training as an organist. And it's very interesting as well that when he came to this country, in an era when there wasn't television and stuff like that, that he acquired a Polish accent. Well, the guy was born in London, and his mother was Irish. So where he got a Polish accent from, I don't know. Anyway, I didn't try to replicate that when I moved over here from England. So we have this incredible piece that is transcribed for orchestra, very grand, as I said, and it's turned up on countless occasions in popular culture. The first section, as I said, is called a toccata, which is like a very free section and doesn't really have a lot of structure or form about it at all. But then the fugue, as maybe some of you know, a fugue is a very strict and very disciplined musical structure. And although this begins quite simply, it builds up into a very grand and a very colorful organ and then orchestral statement. We're not going to listen to any of that just now, but I'm going to move on to the next piece in the program, the Glass Concerto Fantasy for Two Timpanists. Now, Philip Glass, as you, I'm sure, know, is a modern-day composer. And this work was commissioned by Jonathan Haas. And Jonathan originally asked Glass to write a concerto for him, solely as a timpanist. But the work grew and grew, and in the end, they needed two pairs of hands to do it. So it became this concerto fantasy for two timpanists. And Jonathan travels around performing this with many orchestras. I've done it with him before. And here in Fort Wayne, we have our own wonderful Eric Schweikert, who is going to be, well, there he is on the screen. Eric Schweikert, our principal timpanist, who's going to be joining us for this concert. So the piece was written in 2000, and Glass's style is described as minimalist. And one of the features of this is the really repetitive and insistent rhythms. And these figures, they burrow right into your consciousness. And the music is extended in ways that seem less sophisticated than we're used to in lots of, let's say, earlier 20th century music. So why don't we listen to the opening of the glass? I think you'll agree those rhythms, those melodic fragments are very insistent, and I suspect a lot of you like me are thinking Mission Impossible. Yeah, does it remind you of that? Well, apparently after hearing it for the first time, Philip Glass said, oh, yes. So, quite a surprise there. Now, this is, it follows on very much from the closing concerts of last season when we had Michael Dougherty's Hell's Angels. It was as much music theater as anything else. And although this is purely supposed to be a musical piece, it's very dramatic visually because originally it was conceived for just 9 drums, 9 timpani, but on stage we actually have between, I think, 15 and 18, which is an awful lot of drums. And when I first programmed this piece, I never thought about where they would be, which of course is right beside me. And you've got these two wildly enthusiastic guys bashing the living daylight of these drums. So feel for me while you're enjoying the music, won't you? Let's move on to the next work on the program, Mahler's Symphony No. 4 in G major. A lot of people describe this as the thinking man's Mahler because there are no trombones in it. I'm only saying, that's how it's described. There we are, 1860 to 1911, not a very long life. And Mahler primarily was a conductor of opera. He started his conducting career, I think, in Budapest, and he moved to Hamburg, Vienna, and then came to this country to be involved with the Metropolitan Opera. And a lot of the time we think of Mahler with these huge orchestral tapestries. This being the Fourth Symphony, think of the Second Symphony, the Resurrection Symphony, with a huge orchestra, huge chorus and soloists, and then the Third Symphony with an even bigger orchestra, bigger chorus, more soloists, more sound. He scaled things down dramatically for this. The symphony is all really gauged around or hinges around the final movement. And for this, he used a song that he'd written in 1892. This symphony was written 1899 to 1901. We have to remember as well that Mahler was a composer of the summertime. In other words, when he'd finished with all of his conducting engagements, he'd go off on vacation, and his different holiday homes, he had little sheds built at the end of the garden, he'd go and lock himself away, and he'd compose these gargantuan symphonies. So he uses this song from 1892, Das himmlische Leben, Heavenly Life, and it's very much the cornerstone of the whole piece. And it's sung by a soprano, although a lot of people, including Leonard Bernstein, thought that it should really be a boy soprano, and he did perform it quite a few times like that with a boy soprano. And it paints a very naively idealistic vision of heaven. Mahler, of course, was always wrestling with the biggest and the most unanswerable questions about life. In the first movement, it's unusually restrained. It opens with flutes and sleigh bells. I can't think of other symphonies that open with sleigh bells. In the second movement, he can't help himself but refer to the more nightmarish aspects of night and darkness. And this character, Freund Hein, friend Henry, who is a skeleton played on the fiddle, played by the concertmaster, appears. And this is a sort of dance macabre effect that we have there. The finale, as I said, was written way in advance of the other movements. And the soprano sings about the feast being prepared for the saints and about animals willingly going to their slaughter. As I said, it was naive in this bountiful paradise. It ends very quietly and it's very tranquil at the end. There are no elements of triumph. There's no bombast or anything like that, like in the earlier symphony. So, Greg, could we hear some of the last movement of Mahler's Fourth Symphony? Season, and as in previous years for the first concert, it actually begins at 6 p.m., not at 8 p.m., so I hope you'll make sure you're there in good time for that. It's going to be a wonderful and very dramatic event. Now, early spring in October, Must be the shoe man, mustn't it? But we're beginning, and I said there was an unintentional Disney theme that keeps reoccurring in this season. And not only is Rossini's overture to William Tell known to everybody as the theme for the Lone Ranger, but it was also used in Mickey Mouse's 1935 appearance in the band concert. There we are. Disney was always somebody to latch on to great classical music because he didn't have to pay composers to do it, and it was always public domain stuff, and it was cheap and very commercial. Great mind. I'm not going to play any of the overture because I think you might have heard it before. Certainly hoping so. But just to point out that it was written in 1829. It's the last of Rossini's 39 operas, and it really falls into two parts. You have the opening with a wonderful cello solo with four other cellos supporting that. That's meant to represent dawn. And then, much as Berlioz did later on, the timpani come in to represent thunder and the impending storm. We have a very dynamic section that comes after that. And then we have the section that has the English horn, or cor anglais, as I call it, solo, the call to the cows, because of course this is all taking place in the Swiss Alps. And then finally we have the cavalry charge, closing gallop, the Lone Ranger. I can't help but say that. After the Rossini, an absolutely gorgeous concerto by Erich Wolfgang Korngold, his concerto in D major. And on this occasion, we're going to be welcoming back to Fort Wayne a very, very good friend of mine. He's the concertmaster of the Baltimore Symphony. That's Jonathan Carney. And John was here last year directing a concert in our chamber orchestra series. He's going to be doing that again this coming season. That's a wonderful Stradivarius violin he plays there. It's a particularly gorgeous instrument. Just a little bit about Korngold. He was born in 1897 in Brno. He was a son of a very eminent musicologist, Julius Korngold. He was incredibly precocious. Mahler heard him. Mahler, amongst many others, described him as a genius. But he made his career after 1934 in Hollywood. And he came over to this country to write the music, or rather rearrange the music, for Mendelssohn's A Midsummer Night's Dream for the movie of that year. One thing led to another, and he realized he was going to really have a successful career and was something of a pioneer of movie scoring. Had a lucky break in 1938 when he'd returned to Austria to conduct some opera. 1938 wasn't a very good time to go back to Austria if you were Jewish. And he decided that he would respond to a request to go back to Hollywood, and rather well for him that he did, because he wrote the music for a new movie there, Robin Hood. And that really saved his life. He felt that very much. And for the next 8 years, he composed a lot of great movie scores. The violin concerto was written in 1945, is dedicated to the widow of the composer Mahler, that is Alma Mahler. And it's richly chromatic and very lush, but he used a lot of his movie music from 1937 and 39 to put this piece together. So maybe we can hear a little bit of, this is Gil Shaham playing this. Glorious, gorgeous Korngold, played by a fabulous violinist. And I'm thrilled we'll be joined by another fabulous violinist to play it here in Fort Wayne. Now, the symphony in the program is Schumann's Spring Symphony. And Schumann, of course, was regarded as a great composer of songs and of piano music. But his wife wrote once, "It would be best if he composed for orchestra. His imagination cannot find sufficient scope on the piano." And this might well have been true. And in the end, Schumann did actually write four symphonies. But in this first symphony that he wrote, at the first rehearsal, which was conducted by Mendelssohn, he showed his lack of experience, really, at writing for the orchestra at that time, because the trumpets couldn't actually play the first chord of the piece. They were transposing instruments at the time, and Mendelssohn looked at the score and said, "Robert, come look at this. They can't play that, so I'm going to write it down a third." So the opening fanfare, as we hear today, is not quite as Schumann envisaged this. I'd heard this story a lot of times, and then a few years ago, I was very fortunate to be in the music section of the Library of Congress in Washington, and they said, "Would you like to see the manuscript of Schumann's first symphony?" Oh, yeah, just a bit. So they gave me the little white gloves, opened the score, and I saw on the front page the corrections, which apparently are in Mendelssohn's hands. But Schumann went on to be a great symphonist beyond that, despite the criticisms of Mahler and Shostakovich beyond that, who reorchestrated some of his music. So that is our early spring concerts. It's on October the 1st, 8 o'clock, regular time. And there are two opening concerts of the Philharmonic season. And in a little while, we'll go on to discuss the remaining concerts of the season.
An Evening with the Maestro was taped in front of a live audience at the Reinhardt Music Center by College Access Television at IPFW.